Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. So I will be talking about surgical anatomy and understanding the concepts. I have no financial interest to disclose. So to start with the development, eyelid develops from the reduplication of surface ectoderm and with the formation of lead fold at 7th week of gestation that fuse together at 9th week of gestation and re-separates in 6th month of gestation. The usual anatomy of upper eyelid usually studied in two lamina. Anterior lamina consists of a skin and orbicularis muscle. Posterior lamina consists of tarsus, muscles, conjunctiva. So what is important aesthetically is contour of the upper eyelid. So contour is influenced by heredofamilial, racial, and aging factors. Position of the lateral canthus is 2 mm higher than the medial canthus, and this is slightly more in Asian population. Highest point of the contour of the upper eyelid is just nasal to the center of the pupil. Similarly, the lid crease has racial differences. Upper lid crease tends to be highest in location in Caucasian population at around 8 to 12 mm above the lid margin because of the larger tarsus height in the Caucasian, that is about 10 mm as against to 6 to 8 mm tarsus height in Asian population. Orbital facial network is condensation of deep fossa of the orbit that provides supports to the globe and adnexa. Orbital facial network consists of orbital septum, canthal ligament, orbital ligament in the upper orbit with null ligament. In the lower part of the orbit is Lockwood ligament. Similarly, the fat collection is also important aesthetically that gives the gentle and smooth contour to the upper and lower eyelids. You have two fat pocket in the upper eyelid and three fat pocket in the lower eyelid. Beginning and laxity of the septum with the aging causes prolapse of the orbital fat. Eyebrow is another anatomical structure that is aesthetically very important. It is a smooth arc across the superior orbital rim. The ideal extent of the eyebrow should be around 0.5 to 1 centimeter medial to the medial canthus, the vertical line drawn from this point, and it should extend to the point that is drawn tangentially from the temporal part of the lower eyelid. Shape and density of the hairs determined by the genetics, race, and gender. Female usually have higher location of the eyebrow compared to male. Highest point of the eyebrow is superior to the lateral limbus. Various muscles are present in the eyebrow region. Main elevator is the frontalis muscle. Depressor is depressor supercilii, corrugator supercilii, and procerus medially, and orbicularis oculi and oculi centrally and laterally. So contraction of different muscles gives rise to different rhytids. So this is horizontal rhytids at upper part of the nose that is formed by contraction of the procerus muscle. This is vertical rhytids formed due to contraction of the vertical, corrugator supercilii and depressor supercilii muscles. In the prominent rhytids in the upper part of the forehead is due to frontalis muscles. Eyebrow region has definite fat collection and that is known as retroorbicularis oculi fat, that is ROOF. Similarly, other area of the face that is now in the region of oculofacial aesthetic surgeon is the mid face. Mid face is the malar region bounded bordered superiorly by tear trough, laterally by sideburn and pretagal skin, medially by nose and nasolabial folds, and inferiorly by corner of the mouth. Superficial musculoaponeurotic system or SMAS is a thin superficial fossa spanning the entire face. It is continuous with the frontalis muscle fossa and attached to the superficial temporal fossa and platysma. It is an irregular loose interwoven network of collagen, elastin muscle, and fat that invest the orbicularis muscle. Main function of the SMAS is to transmit the facial muscular contraction to the skin via dermal insertion, thereby generating facial expressions. Midface has some universal muscles, that is levator alacnagi, levator levi superioris, and zygomaticus major, that is present in all 100% of the population. Some minor muscles of the midface is zygomaticus minor, that is present in 36%, and still in lesser number of population, rhizoreus muscle, that is only 6% of the population. similar to the brow region, midface also has definite fat collection at the margin of the maxillary bone in the lower orbital wall. Is the SOOF, suborbicularis oculi fat. It extends just below the inferior orbital rim and has connection with the overlying S-mass. Surgical elevation and fixation of the SOOF support lower lid where malposition is caused by midface ptosis. So coming to the basic principles of oculofacial aesthetic surgery, it is not now confined to the oculoplastic surgeon alone, so whenever possible, one should take help from the dermatologist, maxillofacial surgeon, and comprehensive plastic surgeon. At the same time, one should ensure the subspecialized care of eyelid, orbital, and lacrimal tissues. Consistent surgical results depends upon optimal preoperative preparation, patient counseling, oculoplastic, ophthalmic, psychological, and general physical condition evaluation. One should understand the concern of the patient and discuss the goal of the treatment to the patients. Before surgery, we have to have laboratory and ancillary evaluation. Procedure can be done under local anesthesia with or without sedation, and either under general anesthesia. Before surgery, one need to stop antiplatelets and aspirin, or has to continue with the antidiabetic or antihypertensive drugs. For incision, in the procedure for the bloodless incision and bloodless dissection of the tissue, Ilmen radio frequency is the very good tool that cuts the tissue without exerting any pressure, controls bleeding, and reduces the surgical times. Incision in the oculofacial surgery should be given parallel to the skin fold, that is relaxed skin tension line. Whenever possible, one should use concealed incision location, either along the eyebrow or hair lines. One should avoid the vertical incision in lateral commissure that can cause chronic lymphedema. During giving incision, one should keep the scalpel or instrument vertical to the surface. If you are using knife, one should use the edge rather than tip. Incision should start away from the surgeon and should come towards the surgeon. Whenever you are putting the incision, one should keep the surface stretched. Hemostasis is a very important part in the success of oculofacial plastic surgery. So hemostasis should be, one should take preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative measures to control the bleeding. As a part of preoperative measures, BP should be controlled. One should ensure the normal profile of coagulation and bleeding. Whenever possible and medical condition allow, one should use higher concentration of adrenaline. And some usual features like, usual measures like head end elevation, one can do. During the intraoperative period, direct pressure, cold solution, adrenaline pack can be used. And now we are using cautery, bipolar cautery, or unipolar cautery, or CO2 laser also. For the less scar and cosmetically good suturing, one should use appropriate suture and needle. Oculofacial aesthetic surgery can be either in the form of open surgery or endoscopic guided surgery, or now we are using so many non-surgical procedures. In non-surgical aesthetic procedure, face augmentation in the form of dermal filler, we have detailed talk in this session. Some other facial rejuvenation procedures like resurfacing and adjuvant procedure like botulinum toxin can be done in oculofacial aesthetic surgery. Thank you.